Is it sunny there today?
Yes, it's sunny day, but it's not so warm. I think that like in summer, like in summer, there is fresh air. Yeah, it's like spring.
Okay, yeah, and you can use that word cool to describe the air when it's like a little bit cold. You could say cool.
It's cool. It's cool. Yeah.
Yeah.
But you use also this word in order to make an exclamation of cool. Oh, no. That could be this word has two different meanings, no? Depending on the situation, you could say, oh, it's cool.
Yeah, it's true. You
Not
can
that
use
to
it in
say
different
something is very,
situations.
very interesting, you know, something that surprise you, not cool.
Yeah, it's a word I say all the time, like an exclamation, like,
Yes.
oh, cool.
Yes.
Yeah, but it's also used to describe temperature too. So you can say
Yeah.
that, like, I know in Italian you would say fresco, right? Like in Spanish. Yeah.
Fresco.
So instead, when you're talking about the temperature, you would say cool.
Yeah. Are
Yeah.
you also interested in Spanish teacher?
Yeah, I speak Spanish too. Yeah,
Ah, you
and
speak
Italian.
Spanish. Oh, good. Yes, because I'm having lessons in Spanish lessons, you know, in Berlin also.
Good. Wow. Okay. And our
Yeah,
other student that's with us, Jose, he's actually from Spain. So maybe he could help us with our Spanish skills. Yeah, Jose.
lot,
Yes.
yes. I like a lot, yes, because it is very similar to Italian, but some differences that more interesting. Some idioms are the same like in Italy, as in Italy.
You have the same idioms?
See, no, some of them are the same, and they are using the, what can I say? Nosotros, no, non so, no, we say passato remoto in italiano, no? They use a lot of the preterite tense. Instead, we use the preterite perfect in Italian. A lot the preterite perfect in Italiano.
Oh, the present perfect?
The present perfect, see?
Okay.
I made a mix of English and Spanish. Preterite
That's okay. We understand you. It's all right. You can mix all the languages here. It's okay. All right. Jose, have you seen a lot of similarities too between Italian and Spanish?
Yes, I think both languages have some similarities.
That's cool. Have you learned any Italian in the past,
No,
Jose?
no.
Not yet.
I have never learned Italian language.
Italian.
Okay. Well, maybe you could learn in the future. It's really similar to Spanish,
Yeah.
so it'd probably be easy for you.
I found that the Spanish are very hospitable. I don't know, say very
Hospitable?
hospitable. Yes, hospitable. Very hospitable. Yes, they are very friendly. Because I went this summer for in a cruise on the Balearic Islands, and so I found many people that are very friendly, kindly, you know, something like this. Yes,
In the Canary Islands?
yes.
Canary Islands?
Ibiza, Barcelona,
Oh, okay.
Palma de Mallorca.
Okay, the islands that are there, like off of the coast of Barcelona.
Yes.
Okay,
Near the
cool.
coast of Barcelona, see. I mean, that may be in front of the coast of Barcelona.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, you could say off the coast
Yeah.
of Barcelona. Very good. Great job.
Yeah.
Well, that's nice you got to go on vacation there. I'm glad it went well. It's really
Yes.
cool.
Yes.
We also had another student join us named Fred. Hi, Fred.
Hi. Hi,
Hey, how
teacher.
are you today?
Fine, thank you. I just wake up.
You just woke up. Okay. I know it's really early there, right?
Yep. It's 5 a.m.
5 a.m. Wow. Yeah, you have to be a very dedicated student to study English at 5 a.m. And remind me where you're from. I can't remember.
I'm from Ecuador.
That's right. Yeah. Okay, nice to see you again. Thanks for joining us.
In my case, the sun is already arrived. It's 12 o'clock.
Yeah, it's like noon here in Europe. So for everyone in North and South America, it's very early in the morning still. Yeah,
because the sun is going to rise. Master, it's not yet arrived.
Yeah, okay. We have one student.
There is a delay.
Yeah, there's a little bit of a time difference for us.
Time difference, yes.
All right, so today in this class, we're going to be talking a little bit about food poisoning and different illnesses that you can get from eating food that's maybe a little bit old or hasn't been cleaned very well. And so I wanted to start by asking everyone if they have had an experience getting food poisoning before. So maybe I can ask Vincenzo first. Have you ever had food poisoning?
Oh, yes. I can't remember something very dangerous, but sometimes I have to say that there were some kind of meat that I didn't digest very well. So, you know, when in this case you have to go to the bathroom immediately. But in this case I don't have a very bad experience with some kind of meat or other things that they are very, I can say, rotten. I can say rotten or
rotten.
So I would say here that my son that is working in India, that they are difficult in this case because they keep the food in a manner not very hygienic, I'm going to say, he's in Mumbai. So he has to boil the water, the other things. But sometimes I heard some people, when they got down from the airplane, because the air is not so clean as the air in Italy or other part of the world, they had a reaction, you know, that some vomit.
Oh, wow.
Yes, because they are used to burn, what can I say, corpse, in the air. Something like this in India. Do you know?
What do they burn?
Burn dead man, dead woman in the air, yes.
They burn them?
Yes, they burn. Also in the sea. So the air is not so good. There is a lot of contamination in this case, you know, contamination.
That's gross.
So it's possible that you don't agree when you get down from the air. Airplane, the air. He said that when he come here, it seemed that to be on the mountains, to breathe the air of the mountains, because there is a lot of difference. Yeah.
Wow, I didn't even think of that. Air pollution is causing some sickness. Wow.
So it's why I don't want to go there. To see him, yes, because I'm afraid to, in this case, because I have to pay attention to a lot of things that I'm not used to. So
it's true.
It's sufficient that you make a little error that could be, I couldn't say, when you eat something that is not good, that is, I didn't say, that is rotten, that is, yes. So, you know, the automatism is very difficult to give up the automatism, no? Because sometimes, yes, that's what happened to me when, for example, I make something that is automatic. Sometimes, for example, when I leave my house, I want to put the alarm of the house. I forgot because I didn't have the habit to make this act. So generally, I think to put the alarm, and when I go out, I forgot to put the alarm. I don't know if you ever had the same experience.
No, that has happened.
When you have an automatism, it's very difficult to change. Eh? That makes a lot of things.
Used to the convenience of things.
Yes. So I didn't have a bad experience in this sense, but just a slight experience that some food was not in the right way. How can I say? Wasn't good. Yes. So it caused me some disturb, but it was not so. How can I say? So dangerous.
Yeah, it was not.
Yes. Yes, I want to hear about other students.
I saw we had Aka join us too. Hi, Aka. Welcome.
Yes, hello. How are you?
Hello. Welcome back. How are you?
Yes, I'm fine. Thank you.
All right. We're talking a little bit about food poisoning, and I was just asking other students if they've had any experiences with food poisoning before. Aka, maybe I can ask you, have you ever been food poisoned before?
Yes, this summer, this summer, I preserved the mushroom in the freezer, and I put it in a ramen noodle, but at that time I was hurry, so it was not cooked yet. It has not cooked. It's still a bit frozen, but I ate it, and next day I was terrible. Yeah.
Okay. So what were your symptoms of? Were you like throwing up?
No, not throwing up, but diarrhea.
Oh, like other symptoms. Okay. Yeah.
So.
Okay. Wow. So you have to be careful.
Yeah. So I realize maybe mushroom, frozen mushroom, needs to be enough cooking, you know.
Yeah, maybe you would have to boil it completely.
Yeah, yes.
Wow, okay. So I'm glad it wasn't too serious, though, at least. How long did it last? How long were you sick for?
At that day, I just went to the drugstore to buy the drug, some medicine for that. And after that, symptom was eased.
Okay.
And next, I could go out. Yeah.
Okay, that's good. That's not too bad. Only one day. That's good. Sometimes it lasts a long time when you get food poisoning. Let's ask Jose too if he's had any experiences. Jose, have you ever had food poisoning before?
Yes, last summer I had a bad experience. I had in the fridge some mayonnaise, and I didn't check it, and after that I ate it, and I felt something strange in my stomach. I had a little stomach ache. Nothing more, but I think when it's on summer, you have to be careful with these kind of products.
Yeah, the mayonnaise, it has raw eggs in it, I think.
Yes.
And cooked. So they can carry a lot of bacteria.
I think that this product could be out of date. I didn't check it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you could say maybe expired.
Yes.
You have always to make attention. Make attention to the expiring date. It's very
important.
You
have to check. It's important.
Because we have a lot of elements in the fridge, but
can I say Michelle the word lab seed or no?
Lab seed. Well, it's pronounced like lapsed. The E is silent in that ED ending.
Lapsed. Okay. Lapsed. Labs.
But
has the same meaning that expired?
No.
No, it's different.
Yeah, at least for American English. I'm not sure about British English, but in American English, we would say the food is expired.
Expired, okay.
Or, like you said, out of date, too.
Out of date, okay.
We use that expression, too. But lapsed, it's not
Lapsed.
really used in that way. Yeah, we could say, like, there's the expression time lapse photography.
Okay.
Where time passes by and they leave the shutter open for a long time, time-lapse
Yes.
photography. But yeah, it's kind of like an old word that by itself it's not really used
Okay.
like that. Yeah. But nice question. Yeah, thanks for asking. Okay, so let's also ask Fred. Fred, you live in Ecuador, so it's a little bit different from like maybe Asian or Europeans. Like a situation, like you guys have different foods there and everything. So, have you ever had food poisoning? Have you ever gotten sick from something that you ate?
Yeah. 2 years ago, I was watching TV and suddenly I start to feel an intense stomach ache. So I have to go to the doctor and I get some pills, some medicine. And later after 2 hours, I recovered, but I can't remember what was that I ate. I can't remember.
Okay. And did it make you throw up too?
Yeah, throw up and
Yeah.
I feel terrible.
It's good that you went to the doctor right away, though. That probably saved you.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good. So I guess I can tell you guys my experience. I guess I've had a lot more bad experiences with food poisoning than you guys have. So once, it was like 4 years ago, I ate some fish at a restaurant, and it was catfish, it's called. I'm not sure if you guys, I think Akka, you've heard of catfish because you were in Atlanta.
Catfish.
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 Maybe I know what it is like, but I don't know.
Okay,
I
it's a really big fish. Anyway, so I got some from a restaurant, but I guess it wasn't cooked well or something, because like 2 hours later, I had a lot of vomiting and diarrhea, and it lasted like I couldn't even drink water, and it was for 3 days, I think, and I was like on the floor, totally dehydrated. And I couldn't drink water, I couldn't drink anything, because everything made me throw up. It was horrible. I was really, really sick. I almost went to the hospital because I didn't know what to do. And then later I got when I was that was in the United States too. So they usually have good hygiene in restaurants, but sometimes they don't, I guess. And later I got E. coli, which is a bacteria. Have you guys heard of E. coli?
Sì,
It's a very bad bacteria. And
cavolo.
I got that when I was in the Dominican Republic. So I was sick for almost a month when I had E. coli. It was bad. And I went to the hospital for that, and they had to give me a test because I was sick for too long. Yeah. So I guess I've had more food poisoning than you guys have had. But it's good. I'm glad you haven't had too many bad experiences. So we can look at some common sicknesses that you can get, some common illnesses that are transmitted through food, not being cooked well or maybe being expired, like we learned that word earlier. So I'll give you guys the link here to this article. And this talks about 10 different kinds of foodborne illnesses. And so we'll learn a lot of vocabulary here about different diseases and like health-related vocabulary. So they have a lot of advanced vocabulary in this article. So if you guys have questions, if there's a word that you don't understand or a phrase that you haven't heard before, you can just use your microphone and ask, or you can write it in the chat box, whatever you like. So you guys can open this also in your own browser, or you can follow along on the screen. But I think I'm going to ask Vincenzo first. Vincenzo, maybe you can read the introduction here for us.
Yes, it's with monks start. estoy, digo esto, I am loading my lens.
Can you see? I'll make it a little bit bigger.
I'm trying to enlarge. Okay, it's okay. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yeah, we can hear you. Yeah.
Okay. All it takes is just one drop of salmonella contaminated liquid from improperly handled or stored raw chicken to contaminate another food or liquid. That contamination can happen either through direct contact or indirectly through contaminated kitchen utensils or cutting boards. About 48 million people, that's about one in six, and most under the age of 5 or over 65, get sick with a foodborne illness every year in the U.S. Of those, 128,000 are hospitalized and 3,000 die. Okay.
And you can continue if you like. You can read the whole page. There are two more paragraphs. Yeah.
Foodborne illnesses are caused by different types of pathogens, including commonly thought of sources such as bacteria, viruses, and parasites.
Parasites, yeah.
Parasites. In addition to the ones that don't come to mind as often, such as pollutants and toxins. The most common foodborne pathogens are Salmonella, responsible for 38% of reported foodborne infections, followed by Campylobacter, responsible for 35% of reported infection. Both of those cause gastrointestinal problems and fever, and both are usually self-limiting, lasting about 10 days or less. While none of that sounds like a good time, here we have 10 foodborne illnesses that do move, then keep you on the bathroom. Yes, it was happening to me. The floor for a night or two. Okay. These pathogens paralyze your muscles, cause explosive and watery diarrhea, and may even make you think hot feels cold, and cold feels hot. Hot feels hot. It's very strange.
Yeah. So it would affect your nervous system there. Yeah. And do you have questions about the vocabulary?
No. So I will try to understand the final. The hot feels cold and the cold feels hot.
Okay. Do you know what a cutting board is?
No.
A cutting board?
Cutting board, no, I don't know.
Okay. These are some pictures of a cutting board. It's like the board that you have in the kitchen that you can use to cut vegetables or...
Yes. Cutting board. But it's a piece of wood that you use, a piece of wood or plastic that you use in order to cut something, cut meat, and in order to protect the kitchen or not.
Yeah, exactly. Very good.
It's a table, a little table that you put on the kitchen in order to save the... What's it? The counter.
Mm-hmm.
The counter, yes. Save the counter. When you cut something, yes.
Yeah, excellent. Yes. Great job.
Yes.
So these cutting boards can be contaminated sometimes.
Ah, contaminated, yes. If you don't clean it very well.
They can transmit the bacteria, yeah.
So
we can get started right away by looking at some of these terrible diseases, and the first one is really interesting. It's called botulism, and so maybe we can ask Jose if he could read this one.
Yes.
For us.
Yeah. Botulism is a foodborne bacterial infection caused by the bacterium Clostridium botulinum. Well, technically, the body is reacting to the toxins produced by this bacterium. adult intestinal toxemia, infant botulism, and wound botulism are also caused by this bacterium, and it's the muscle paralyzing neurotoxin produced by this bacterium that's used in Botox injections. Botulism begins with fatigue, muscle weakness, and vertigo, and it quickly progresses to abdominal pain and swelling, blurry vision, diarrhea, difficulty swallowing, double vision, severe dry mouth, nausea, and vomiting. As the neurotoxin builds in the body, paralysis begins to set in. The autonomic nervous system begins to fail. There is symmetrical descending paralysis and cranial nerve paralysis, and respiratory muscle weakness leads to respiratory failure. Not only do you wish you were dead, but without prompt treatment, botulism may actually kill you. Food-borne botulism is commonly caused by improperly canned food, but it may also grow in foods that are allowed to sit at room temperature for too long. The incubation period, the time between exposure to the bacterium, eating contaminated food, and the first symptom of infection is typically as few as 12 and 72 hours, but it may range between 4 hours and 8 days. More than 90% of people infected with Clostridium botulinum will have symptoms of the illness within 3 to 5 days, such as Chantak and Bartlett. Infants infected with Clostridium botulinum, however, won't normally develop symptoms until 30 days after exposure, source Food Safety Government. The good news, the bacterium is vulnerable to eat it, bringing a home canned sauce to a boil for 10 minutes before eating it, for example, will kill this bacteria if they are present. Treating botulism requires the administration of an antitoxin. Those with fasted access to the antitoxin and using it before the body is completely paralyzed.
Paralyzed.
Completely paralyzed. May prevent their paralysis from worsening and reduce their recovery time. Source who botulism infections can be fatal. Even after treatment, though less than 5% of those who are treated die. Left untreated, 60% of those infected with the neurotoxin die. Source Arizona Department of Health Services.
Very nice. Good reading.
That's very dangerous.
Yeah.
I didn't know.
Jose, how can you protect yourself against this bacteria, this disease?
How can I protect myself?
Do you remember what it's caused by?
Yes. It's caused by the bacterium Clostridium botulinum.
Yeah, and like, where does this bacteria grow?
This bacteria grow.
Here in this
paragraph. Yes. The first paragraph.
The first symptom. In the first paragraph.
Well. It's like the third paragraph. It's commonly caused by
intestinal bacteria.
No, it says foodborne botulism is commonly caused by.
Caused by the bacterium Clostridium botulinum.
Okay.
It's a foodborne bacterial.
Yeah, very good. And here in the third paragraph, you can see...
In the third paragraph, okay.
Yeah, sorry.
It's commonly caused by improperly canned food. But also grow in foods that are allowed to sit at room temperature for too long.
So maybe... like if you have some food that you can at home.
Yes.
Like you can see in these pictures, like many people preserve their food at home for the winter.
Yes.
So you can be really careful with that, and it says you can maybe boil it for 10 minutes before you eat it. That can protect you.
It's better to boil for 10 minutes in order to protect some disease.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, perfect. Nice. And it's also dangerous to let your food sit at room temperature for too long. So you can, maybe when you finished eating, you can put the leftovers directly in the refrigerator instead of letting them sit. To avoid this bacteria.
Yes, or throw them out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Jose, did you have any questions about the vocabulary used?
No.
Okay. You did a nice job with your reading. You did really well. Yeah. Mm. All right, so let's look at the next disease, the next bacteria here, cholera. And this is a pretty famous one. This is one I think we've all heard of. And maybe Jose, you just read. So, Fred, I think it's your turn. Maybe you can read about cholera here.
Okay. Although cholera infections are rare in the U.S., in other developed countries, developing nations have between 3 million and 5 million cases of cholera reported, and between 100,000 and 120,000 deaths annually. Most of the cases are clustered in Africa, Haiti, and Southeast Asia. Several cases estimated to be 5 to 10% of those affected can be fatal if treatment isn't received promptly. Cholera is a foodborne illness caused by the bacterium Vibrio cholerae, and it occurs after consuming food or water that's being contaminated with feces from a person infected with the bacterium. Contamination may happen through inadequate hand washing and hygiene, or in areas with an inadequate sanitation and water treatment. Cases of cholera in developed nations are rare, and they're most often associated with eating contaminated raw oysters. Cholera's hallmark, profuse diarrhea, won't appear until 2-3 days after exposure to the bacterium. Vibrio cholera is an enterotoxin, which means it's the bacterium that infects the intestines. The toxins produced by this bacterium attack the cells in the lining of the intestine, causing those cells to release large amounts of water with nowhere to go but out. The infection progresses, so generous amounts of foul-smelling watery diarrhea that resembles rice water. The accompanying fast and significant fluid loss causes severe dehydration, and treatment primarily involves rehydration.
Rehydration, very good.
Yeah. Rehydration.
Yeah. So, have you ever? Oh, Fred, I think lost his connection right now. I was going to ask if he's ever had cholera. Like if he's ever heard of this where he lives in Ecuador, because they had this in the Dominican Republic too. Yeah. It's on the same island as Haiti. Hiroki, have you heard of cholera?
Yes, I've heard of that.
But I don't think it's ever been like a problem in Japan where you live, right?
Not a common problem here.
Okay, so how do you think we could protect ourselves from cholera, maybe if we travel to Africa?
Or maybe avoiding water or drinking water or ice. Mm-hmm. But I heard many tourists, got some became diarrhea or something for the water of the restaurant. Or if they avoid water, maybe if they order the kind of pet bottled water, but ice could be troublesome.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's true.
That's a really good point. There's a little bit of an echo. I can hear myself again. But it's a good point. That was something that they reminded us too in the Dominican Republic. They said to make sure that the ice was from filtered water or bottled water, because it's pretty dangerous to get cholera. Very nice. You had a good comprehension there. And the next one has to do with fish poisoning. So it's hard to pronounce. Chiguatera, fish poisoning. So I think, Hiroki, it's your turn, maybe, or Aka, sorry. Maybe you could read this for us.
Okay. While nausea and vomiting are classic symptoms of common foodborne illness, such as Escherichia coli, E. coli, or Salmonella enterocolitis infections, tingling toes and fingers are a sign of a more severe from foodborne illness called Chiguatera fish poisoning. The single cold toxin producing protozoan, the Dinoflagellata gambibilis discus lives on algae in tropical coral reef waters. Small herbivorous fish eat this algae as part of their diet. As nature would have it, these small fish are part of the diet of larger carnivorous fish,
carnivorous
fish,
yeah,
and so on through the food chain. Eventually, we arrive at the large reef fish we commonly consume, barracuda, black grouper, a black fin snapper, a cubera snapper, dark snapper, great amberjack, hogfish, horse eye jack, king mackerel, and yellow grouper. And while chigua toxin is harmless to fish, it's fatal to humans. It's impossible to detect chigua toxin in contamination by a fish's color, odor, or taste. And cooking fish at high temperatures or freezing it won't remove the toxin. The biotoxin affects the body's gastrointestinal system first, before causing neurological symptoms such as pins and needles, feeling or tingling, called paresthesia. The classic symptom of this infection is neurological paradoxical temperature reversal, which means hot things feel cold and cold things feel hot. Cardiovascular symptoms are also common and may include hypertension and pulmonary edema. Symptoms may appear as quickly as 15 minutes after ingesting the toxin, although most commonly symptoms appear between 6 and 12 hours. There is no treatment, and while symptoms have been known to last for days, for some people it can take years to recover.
Awesome job, Aka. Very good. I know there are some really hard words there, so you did a great job.
So we had better not to eat carnivorous fish.
Yeah. It says that it's not even killed when you cook it at high temperatures.
Yeah.
So it's pretty dangerous.
We have to eliminate the carnivorous fish in our diet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I wanted to practice some of the pronunciation of these words. The first one is gastrointestinal.
Gastrointestinal.
Intestinal. Yeah, good job. And so this is talking about the intestines in your abdomen. You know, where the food goes after your stomach. And the intestines. And so the toxins really attack you there. And did you have questions about... Okay, these words, herbivore and carnivore. Are you familiar with those words?
I think so. Herbivore eat maybe seaweed or something, plants. And carnivores eat meat.
Very good.
Yeah.
So when it describes the animals as herbivorous or carnivorous, you can know that they're talking about an herbivore that only eats plants, or a carnivore which also eats meat. And I saw we had Ana Carolina join us. Hi, Ana.
Hi, teacher. I'm sorry. Today I'm really, really late.
It's okay. We're happy that you're with us. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay,
do you have questions?
Yes, I must correct me, teacher, because it's not only that we have to eliminate the carnivorous fish, but also herbivorous fish, all the fish. I thought that it was possible to eliminate this illness by eliminating in our diet carnivorous fish, but it's not so.
Yeah, it's a little bit hard. Yeah, because all of the fish that are big enough to eat, they always eat the smaller fish.
Yeah.
It's
not possible.
Mm-hmm.
That's meditation.
Yeah. Okay, so I think we can go ahead and continue, but yeah, this is one toxin that's very, very dangerous because it cannot be eliminated by cooking, so it's a little bit scary.
Yeah.
All right, so I think next it would be Anna's turn. So Anna, maybe you can read number 7 for us about crypto, this kind of foodborne illness.
Okay. In Milwaukee, Wisconsin, in 1993, more than 400,000 people were sickened after ingesting
cryptosporidiosis.
contaminated drinking water.
Cryptosporidiosis.
Cryptosporidiosis. Code crypto for short is waterborne illness caused by single-celled coccidium parasites called cryptosporidium, and it is responsible for as many as 7.3% of all the diarrhea. Oh my gosh, diarrheal illnesses reported in developed countries. Sorry.
Prevalence
of cryptosporidiosis is greater in developing regions that may not have reliable access.
You're doing good. Don't worry. I know it's really early there.
Okay. That may not have reliable access to clean water sources and sanitation. There are more than 26 known cryptosporidium species. Among them, cryptosporidium parvum and cryptosporidium hominis, which are responsible for most human cases of the infection. It takes as few as 2 to 10 cryptosporidia to cause cryptosporidiosis, an infection in the small intestine, I don't know,
intestine, yeah.
Intestine. Symptoms usually appear an average of 7 days after becoming infected. Watery diarrhea is the most common symptom of a crypto infection. Other symptoms of infection include abdominal cramping, dehydration, fever, nausea, vomiting, and weight loss. Some cryptosporidia are resistant to chlorine used to eradicate bacteria, parasites, viruses, and fungi in all types of water sources, from swimming pools to public water systems. But infections are treatable. Patients are usually prescribed antiprotozoal medication such as
Nitazoxanide, yeah.
As well as fluid replacement. People with healthy immune system typically get better within 2 weeks. Those with compromised immune systems are the most risk of infections and complications.
Mm-hmm. Nice reading. I know there are a lot of technical words there, Anna, but you did a really nice job. I know it wasn't easy. So, Anna, like, have you heard in Brazil of people getting sick from the water?
Oh, yes, it too happens a lot. But I've never heard about crypto before. Mm-hmm. But I heard about a virus. And I don't know how to translate it.
I'm not sure what it is either. Yeah. But I think there are like a lot of small bacteria that are sometimes transmitted by the water.
Yeah. We cannot drink water directly from the tap.
Okay. You have to always drink bottled water in Brazil?
We filter the water. I have 2 filters here in my home. One outside, so I could drink it directly from the tap. But I have 1 more filter inside my home.
Okay. And like, how do the filters work? Do they kill bacteria? Or do they just remove?
No, they kill bacteria because they have a layer with a product. They filter and they have a layer with a product, and the other one ionized. I don't ionize. Oh my God! You know the positive and negative is called the ion.
Oh, okay.
They ionize the water, and then it kills the bacteria and so forth.
Okay, that's really interesting. That's cool that you can use a filtering system there. In the Dominican Republic, we had to always buy really, really large containers with bottled water, and we couldn't use the tap water only for like washing the clothes, but we couldn't use it for hardly anything because there are so many different bacteria in the water. But yeah, you did a nice job. I know there were some really challenging words there. So I think it's back to Vincenzo. Vincenzo, maybe you could read number 6 for us about cyclospora, it's called.
Cyclospora, okay. Consuming fresh produce and plenty of water is normally part of a healthy diet, but even this undeniably good for you habit isn't without risk. Your favorite plant to eat could have bacteria itching a right. Love a fresh summer salad with a side of contamination. Fresh basil, lettuce, and imported raspberries have all been associated with cyclospora outbreaks. In 2014, cyclospora contaminated cilantro imported from Mexico caused 100 26 people to fall ill in Texas. In July 2015, the Department of Social and Health Services, the DSHS, had already accounted for 182 Cyclospora infection in Texas alone. Cyclospora is caused by a single-celled parasite, Cyclospora cayetanensis, which infects the small intestine, and that tiny little salad interloper is responsible for some major human misery. Frequent watery explosive diarrhea, while most cyclospora infections are self-limiting and clear without treatment within a few days to a few months. Some may require treatment. Oh dear, is it this? Oh, at the moment, I can't see anymore.
Okay.
No, there is something that it was over. Okay. A few months, some may require treatment with sulfonamide, antibiotics. Of course, rehydration is a key part of recovery.
Nice, good reading. Very good.
Okay.
So we have to be careful with fresh fruits and vegetables.
I think that overall we must protect our immune system. Yes, that's the way in order to, no? Mm-hmm. To be protect, the way to be protect, no?
Petition
our immune system, because there are lots of possibility to be infected, in this case, from fish, from other aliments, from, yes, a lot of things.
Yeah,
pay attention to expiration date of the aliment.
It's true, yeah, eating expired food can be really dangerous.
Yeah.
And it uses this phrase here, hitching a ride. Yeah, so we can imagine a hitchhiker, and this is a person, I'll show you the picture. This is, in English, a hitchhiker. So it's a person who stands on the side of the road and wants to get a ride for free.
Yeah.
And so it uses that kind of illustrative language to talk about how the bacteria try to hitch a ride. Like it's there on the
it's a ride from the bacteria, but in this case.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's a very strange expression in this case.
Uh-huh. And have you heard of this word before, interloper?
No, that is it. That tiny little salad, interloper. Mm-hmm. Isn't it the name of a bacteria? No? You know, interloper.
No, this is, it's another thing here. It's a noun. Maybe you can put the definition for us. Can you see that?
An interloper, a person who becomes involved in a place or situation where they are not there, not wanting. They are not wanting or are considered not to belong.
So it's somebody that's not wanted that you would say they don't belong here. And it has a little example of how you could use that word interloper in a sentence.
Japanese consumers have in the past been unreceptive to foreign interlopers in the cell phone market. I can't understand very well what's the meaning. The sentence.
So they didn't want other businesses to come into their market, and so they called the other businesses foreign interlopers, because this word means a person or a business that is unwanted.
So like an intruder.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So intruder. It says that this bacteria is like an interloper too in the salad, because we obviously don't want that bacteria in our salad. Yeah. All right. So let's go on. Let's read number 5. We're almost finished, but this is a really bad one.
Excuse me.
Okay. No problem. I think he closed the page. Okay. I was going to mute him. So here we're going to talk about a tapeworm, and this is really gross, but it's something that can happen. So maybe Jose can read about the tapeworm for us.
Okay. Some people believe that ingesting a tapeworm will help with weight loss. One Iowa resident who remains identified ordered a tapeworm on the internet and sold it as her diet strategy. Tapeworm infection most commonly don't happen because you've eaten a tapeworm's food. Three species are responsible for human infections: Tenia saginata, beef tapeworm; Tenia solium, pork tapeworm; and Tenia asiatica, Asian tapeworm. Infections happen after cystercy, the larval form of the parasite, are consumed accidentally while eating undercooked or raw beef or pork from a tapeworm-infected animal. Tapeworms may cause gastrointestinal problems such as abdominal pain and upset stomach, as well as appetite change and weight loss. For many, the infection is confirmed when tapeworm segments are visible in bowel movements. The stuff of nightmares. But it's Tenia solium that's associated with a more severe form of foodborne illness. Cysticercosis causes focal neurologic deficit symptoms, headaches, and visual disturbances, as well as localized striated muscle nodules and pain. More than 50 million people are infected with cysticercosis, making this tapeworm infection the most common parasitic infection around the world. Neurocysticercosis, when the tapeworm affects the neurological system, is the most common brain infection. Plus, it's the leading cause of adult-onset seizures. It takes 2 months for the cysticercosis, the larval tapeworm, to develop into adulthood. Adult tapeworms may live in the small bowel of a human body for years. Tenia solium, for instance, may grow between 6.5 to 23 feet, 2 to 7 meters long, with as many as 1,000 segments, called proglottids, each containing 50,000 eggs within those person.
Excellent reading, very good. And I know there were a lot of hard words there too, but you did a nice job. So this is a really disgusting threat to our health. And so it's something that really motivates us to make sure that we have good hygiene, because we do not want a tapeworm. It says they can grow up to 7 meters long or 23 feet inside of our intestines. So gross, really, really gross. But we have some other illnesses. We don't have time to read them all, but we have some other illnesses here that you guys can read about. This is another kind of worm, and here there's an illness that's transmitted by rats, and one that's transmitted by oysters and other shellfish. So I'll give you guys the link one more time to this article if you'd like to read through the rest of it. But you guys all did a really nice job with your reading. I know it was very, very challenging, but you guys did awesome. And make sure that you're safe with your hygiene, with your food, so we can avoid all of those.
Yeah.
Okay, nice to see you guys. Thank you for your participation today.
Thank you very much.
Okay, bye. I'll see you guys soon.
Bye, Michelle. Thank you.
Have a good day at work. Bye.